that child not to go out there and seek to become the only billionaire in South Africa and close doors for everybody else. But an economic literature that teaches us how to become a communal people in every sense of the word when it comes to the way we share our resources. How to become people who are self-sufficient. How to cease to become consumers. That's what economics must do. Basically say the decolonization process solution could be thematic, however you want to put it, but ultimately it's not a linear thing. It's everybody in every space working towards the common idea. If we must agree that we want us to be an Africa of decolonized people, that is the common objective, right? How we all get to that common objective depends on what we are all doing in the space that we currently want to have. And that's what we need to do. And on the question of how do we set an African agenda, somebody said something very profound. A young woman, unfortunately, I don't know if she's here today or she's not, but a young woman by the name of Mbulelo Nyathela, she's a former PEC member of SASCO in this province. She said something very profound yesterday. We had another discussion of the books at Scopies in there, and Mbulelo said something very profound. She was saying that. Someone will remind me if he's around. That, you know, there was a point in our over the last 10 years or so when we had a semblance of an idea of what an African agenda is. There was a time when the word on everybody's mouth was African Renaissance. We may not have a very clear grasp of it, we may not have been very conversant on the details of it, but we understood this thing called an African Renaissance. Apparently Africans had to work together, strive for a common cause and all that. And this person said, whether it was Nsamo or Lumbulelo, I can't be very sure now when I think back. But this person said that over the past few years, this idea has died. We've stopped hearing about this African Renaissance. What happened to the African Renaissance? And I think that was a very important question that was asked by this comrade. This thing that we were speaking about 5 years ago, called an African Renaissance, when, you know, President TM, everywhere he would stand, would speak about this thing, African Renaissance, Africa, I mean African and all of those things. What happened to that idea? Is it an idea that must still be pursued? Is it an idea that must still be altered? But what happened to that idea? And I think if Tramolo is here, he will come. And I don't want to hog the space and be the one that speaks on this, but I want Tramolo to come and speak to us about what his views were, because they are quite very profound. Because they also then begin to answer a question about what needs to be done to set back the agenda. And one of the ways we can set back the agenda is to go back and revisit that narrative. How we do it becomes an issue of whether or not we are going to critique that agenda in the first place. Because I want to believe that all of us sitting here today, we don't necessarily, even though we had a grasp of what an African Renaissance agenda may have been, there may have been some things we don't agree with, right? That we may have critiqued, whatever the issue of how the economic path of it would be. Some of us did not agree with Nepal. Some of us were on the side of contestants. We are saying Nepal is not a working idea. Some believe Nepal is a working idea. There are some Marxists in the house who will tell us that what is that which they fashion as an idea of a Renaissance and an economic level and so on. But I think that the question of the African Renaissance agenda is an important one that the entire house needs to go back, needs to start speaking about. What is this thing? Did we even understand what the African Renaissance agenda was 5 years or 10 years ago when it was raised? Is it what we still want it to be as? Or do we have a different type of a Renaissance agenda that we also want to fashion for our African continent? And the last question that came was the question about, is the victimization of students in institutions of higher learning a race issue? Both the students and students is a race issue.
Is it determined by race, by culture?
Okay. Look, I think that, when I was 18 years old, and you will hear a lot about this, you read a lot about this in the book. When I was 18 years old, I believed that the only problem in South Africa is white people. It's that white people, they have a problem. You deal with that, you have solved the problem. You don't talk about the problem, it's not here. I was 18 years old when I believed that. I was very, very lucky to have met some mentors along the way. The likes of one of my very close and dearest friends, Pini Lokunen, who then sat me down and said, but this issue of yours and saying it's only white people who have a problem. Yeah, you kind of had a little bit of a point, but it's a bit inadequate. You must interrogate this deeper and much further. So even, you know, if I respond to this question, I think back to that. It can't just be an issue about race or about color. Because, and when I say it's not just an issue about race and color, mind you, I also then want to say, and it's very important that you get to this point, that in South Africa, There is no issue that you can raise about the challenges that we face in this dispensation without the issue of color coming out. Because the issue of color in South Africa is not divorced or mutually exclusive from even the issue of class. So the understanding of even the class question itself becomes inadequate if you do not understand the national question itself. And anybody who seeks to say that it's only a race issue or it's only just an issue about class has done an injustice to that kind of conversation. I do think that primarily because black people, we are a majority in this country, it stands to reason, therefore, that we will be on the receiving end of these systematic inequalities that exist, as the historical dispossession and so on. So the student leaders that you see, it may seem that, because they are blacks are in the majority, most of us, theoretically at least, but I think even practically, because it's happening in institutions, we are very many in these institutions of learning, right? So when we have to go to SRC, to vote and all of that, we are going to vote for our student organizations, which are predominantly black, like your SASCO, so SASCO is the biggest student organization in the country. So if you are going to vote for SASCO, it's predominantly